Welcome inside the RX Muscle Studios in New York for a special episode of Iron Debate, brought to you by SciTech Nutrition, who have been our generous sponsors in the entire post-Olympia tour and all our coverage in this month of October. And of course, our longtime sponsor, Quest Nutrition. A special episode. Why? Because we are joined by an all-star panel we have on the show tonight. Dennis James, Chris Aceto, John Romano, and of course Dave Palumbo here in studio. A lot to digest. We've talked about this show for quite some time. A lot has happened during the Olympia, in the post-Olympia tour, and a lot to break down after that. Once again, rxmuscle.com. If you want to join in, you can join us on the Muscle Central Forum at rxmuscle.com or on the live chat live stream box. As we check in now with our panels, we first go out to Phoenix, Arizona, and go to a man who made his mark on the bodybuilding broadcast world. And of course, we are talking about Dennis the Menace James. Dennis, how are you doing tonight?
I'm good, man. Thank you very much. I appreciate you guys having me back on the show.
Dennis, and of course, whenever we say special episode, it has to include Big D Dennis James. Dennis, what was it like broadcasting the Olympia weekend in the capacity which you did?
Actually, it was awesome. I had a lot of fun. You know, sometimes I forgot that I was live. So, you know, but I guess that's who I am anyways. I like to keep things real. And sometimes I say things that maybe I'm not supposed to say, but people know that's who I am. So I say what I want to say and when I want to say it. And sometimes it just doesn't come out the way it should be. But people understand what I'm trying to say. That's what counts.
Been waiting for the first time that we were going to have you back on RX Muscle to tell you this. But I was keeping track of how many times you started a sentence on the broadcast with, I'm going to keep it real, or some variation thereof, 16. 16 times throughout the course of the weekend that you started a sentence with, I'm going to keep it real. Well done, sir. As we now go to Guadalajara, Mexico, and bring back the man they call Boss Number 2, a man who has made ripples and waves in the RX Muscle Forum over the course of the last week. And of course, we are talking about John Romano. John, how are you doing tonight?
What's happening? I'm doing all right. How about you guys?
John, talk to us about your efforts now in revitalizing the RX Muscle Forums.
Revitalizing? Get a mortician for that. We got to you know, bring people back in and start talking about things that matter. You know, I mean, I don't know what happened. I put a thread up there about, you know, how we can make this place better, and I'm getting a lot of great feedback. And I think some of the things that we need to do are, are give the people what they want. They want certain shows back. They want certain interactions back. They want to be able to do things again. And I think we need to bring that back and get back to our roots and do what made us popular in the beginning.
And we now go to Portland, Maine, bring in the man they call the Technician. And when we sent him the questions for today's show, he basically responded saying, so basically this is the Chris Aceto version of Iron Debate, as we check in with Chris. Chris, how are you doing tonight?
I'm going to keep it real, Sid. 17.
I know our producer Johnny Styles has a running clock on the I'm going to keep it real tally, as we can now go back into the RS Muscle Studios and check in with Dave Palumbo. Dave, we had Guru Mania before the Olympia, and you've wanted to have, again, this all-star panel for Iron Debate after the Olympia, and here we have it.
Yeah, you know, we had Guru Mania before. Obviously, we had Oscar Arden. We had, what's his name? Fakhri, right. There's too many gurus. Fakhri, Mubarak. And I wanted to get Dennis James and Chad Nichols back, but Chad Nichols had to take his son someplace today. But we'll get him next time. But, you know, I just want to mention something. We have the 100th anniversary of the Heavy Muscle TV show coming up in the next few weeks. I'm trying to set a date. One of my childhood friends, Michael Popkin from kindergarten, had a great idea for the show. Since we were going to bring back all the old cast members, and since Derek Anthony is no longer with us, may his soul rest in peace, of course, he suggested we get a psychic here, you know, a psychic medium that we had on one of the shows. I forget what episode we had him on. Maybe we can contact Derek. So, guys, stay tuned. I want you to keep submitting your, I guess you could say, ideas for the Heavy Muscle 100th anniversary show. I'm taking all requests, and we're doing a lot of work trying to set that up.
Once again, this show brought to you by SciTech Nutrition, who's been generous in their support of our post-Olympia coverage. And of course, Quest Nutrition. Try their new pumpkin spice bar. Now, me, myself, I'm not a fan of pumpkin spice anything. But I had the bar. I had it at my local 7-Eleven. It was awesome. It's amazing. And it's a limited time edition, so you want to go out there right now, try it out. Go to questnutrition.com. As we now go to our first topic of debate, the man they call the Blade, the ageless wonder, Dexter Jackson. And right now, there isn't a hotter name in the world of bodybuilding than that man, Dexter Jackson, coming off his win at the Prague Pro, coming off his win at the Arnold Europe, capping off three Arnold victories. He now has literally a handful of Arnold victories, finished second at the Olympia. Now, this is a topic when you talk about the greatest of all time, the greatest generation of all time, and that's obviously a subjective debate. Dennis, we're going to go to you first on this one. Statistically speaking, is Dexter Jackson the best bodybuilder of all time, in your opinion?
Well, let me say something before I get to that. Would anybody have a problem with if he would have won the Olympia and we could say he won every show this year?
We're going to get to that next.
Yes. It is like
part B to this topic of conversation.
All right. Anyways, yes, let me tell you this. Me and Dexter, we both turned pro in 98. We both started competing as a pro in 99. He started at the Arnold and he did his first Olympia in 99. I qualified for the Olympia in 2000. So, and I'll have to say, and I'm going to say it here, and I'm going to say it with, like I said, I'm going to keep it real. And I know we have Arnold, we have my idols like Lee Haney, 8-time Mr. Olympia, Ronnie Coleman, 8-time Mr. Olympia. We got Arnold Schwarzenegger, all these guys that are tremendously important, and they make this sport what it is today. But I'm going to say it right now. Dexter Jackson is, for me, the most consistent bodybuilder and the best bodybuilder that ever to hit any IFBB stage, and not because he's 46 years old right now, but because he's been doing this for almost 20 years as a pro, and he's still doing it as the second best bodybuilder on this planet. I got to give him the props. Yes, for me, I think he is the all-time best bodybuilder.
John, we're going to go to you, and this is and Dennis said the key word there. Consistent. That is a word that we have always heard when it comes to Dexter Jackson, one of the most, if not the most, consistent of all time. But we're going to go to you on this one. Statistically speaking, and we just rattled off his recent accolades, is he statistically the best bodybuilder of all time, in your opinion?
I don't have the statistics of everybody else to compare it to, but from my own experience, watching Dexter compete for the last 20 years, you know, DJ's right. This is the most consistent bodybuilder ever. I have never seen this cat show up out of shape. He's been within 2% of his best every single time he shows up on stage. So, and he shows up on stage quite a bit. Now, you know, but you gotta segregate these guys into epics. Oh, epochs, if you want to say that. You know, you got the mid-90s, so you got Flex Wheeler, Kevin Lavrone, you know, phase. He fits into there. You got, you know, Ronnie Coleman, Jay Cutler. But, you know, Dexter's always been there. He's woven his way through that whole, you know, row of guys through all of those years. And he's always been knocking at the door. He's always there. He's always a threat. He's always the guy that you got to worry about. You can guarantee that if Dexter's in a show, he's coming in on the money. So statistically, I would say from a consistency standpoint, absolutely the best bodybuilder that's ever competed.
Consistency, we talked about what he's been able to do, the longevity that he's been able to do it with. In the post-Olympia, the superstar seminar, Phil Heath once said, when he was asked, who threatened him the most out of this field and who threatens him the most in the bodybuilding world? He said, look, if Dexter Jackson ever comes in on, that's the man that can knock me off my pedestal. Chris, let's go to you. Your opinion, is Dexter Jackson statistically the best bodybuilder of all time?
Well, it turns out that that Phil, Mr. What If, was right in that prediction. I just don't think he was sincere in the prediction about. The irony is I don't think he considered Dexter a threat. Having said that, I think that Dexter statistically is the best inconsistency, but I wouldn't call him the best. No disrespect to him. I mean, you know, you can have, let's say someone, to draw the analogy, someone could have 10 businesses and one could have had 5 epic crazy years and then eventually went out of business. And then he could have one of the 10 that was incredibly consistent for 25 years. You know, which one do you consider your, you know, all-time greatest business? It might be the one that was, you know, generated 5 years of just monumental income. I guess I'm comparing him to, you know, the likes of Dorian or Lee Haney. Obviously, I don't think he would have beaten those guys. But in terms of his consistency, it's beyond remarkable, actually. And what's more remarkable is that he's consistent coming from a bantamweight. You know, it's one thing to say, like, well, he won as a, you know, a heavyweight, and then he did really good in the pros for 25 years or how long he's been around, or not very good, but he's been a winner or second or third or fourth type guy. But he came from, like, you know, a bantam to a lightweight. Just being able to win a national level show as a light heavy like he did, coming from a bantam or a lightweight, is just mind-boggling. So, you know, his consistency is, we'll never, ever, ever, ever see it in bodybuilding. Probably if you take it into context, what your body goes through, injuries, you know, people's physiques get worse over the years as they get older. They lose their legs, their waist gets wider. You know, his level of consistency and duration rivals, you know, the baseball player who played for 20, 25 years or 300 games. Who's the guy who played baseball for 300 years? Cal Ripken.
There you go, the Iron Man.
I mean, Cal Ripken, you know, nothing against him, but he can, you know, he can play it safe. He can play the outfield. He can play shortstop. You know, you're not grinding away with Charles Glass every day, 350 different angles, 365 days a year. You know what I mean? Your body gets beat up. And the thing with Dexter is there's nothing beat up about him. You know, he doesn't have, like, well, the left quad is torn. His delts are getting smaller. I would have to agree with Johnny. He's like 2% of his best for 20 straight years. It's remarkable, you know, and it might be so remarkable that we're probably maybe not giving him his props, but I just wouldn't consider, like, statistically the best.
Again,
I would say the statistically the most consistent.
Let me debate you on that. You say statistically he's not the best. I mean, who had more shows than Dexter? Who won more shows than Dexter? Nobody. No. Now let me say this, because you said he would never beat Dorian. Yes, because Dorian did one show a year. That was the Olympia. Let Dorian do 5 shows and coming off, Dexter beat him.
Absolutely.
Dexter would beat anybody. If they're not
absolutely, 100%. I'm just no. You have no disagreement from me. What I'm saying is that's why I use the business model, or, you know, I'm thinking real estate. I could own the Empire State Building, and a Freedom Tower. I could own that and then lose it. You can have one marquee, meaning Dorian Yates for 4 years was unbelievable, or you could have 400. You know, smaller apartment buildings that generate far more money than the one big building. Which one is more successful in real world terms? Probably at the bottom line, the one that generates income for life and for generations to come, which would be not the Empire State Building.
That's the way I judge it. I didn't judge it by Dexter being the biggest. Of course, Lee Haney won the Olympia 8 times. I'm not going to argue about that. Well, what I'm saying is, Dexter's been there. He won every show. He won the Olympia. He won the Arnold 5 times. He won all other Arnolds several times. So when I'm looking at who is the best bodybuilder, I'm not saying the biggest or the shortest or the tallest or the one that had the most popular, or was the most popular or had the most fans. But when I'm looking at a bodybuilder that had the complete package of not only having the least weaknesses, but also being the one that competed the most, which most of these guys couldn't even do, I had to give it to Dex.
Yeah, you're probably right, DJ. I see your point completely.
You also have to consider what the point Chris brought up is that he turned pro. He won as a bantamweight. Okay, this cat put on 100 pounds of muscle over the course of his career. All right. And to be that consistent, to gain that much weight and come in that consistent every single time he comes out, I think you need to, sort of define in a little bit more granular means what you mean by statistically, because you can go by most wins, then, you know, we can count those up. You can go by, you know, most consistent turnout, and we can count those up. But if you take component by component, what it takes to be a top level pro, and dissect that and put it all into a category, I think you'll see Dexter at the top or near the top of every single one of those.
Yeah, I think you're right. You're right. I think if you define it that way, John, categorize it, you're absolutely right, because just because there's no statistic where you can beat up on him on, where, you know, where you I mean, I think the probably the more amazing part that DJ pointed out that I didn't realize is the total number of shows he's done. Because anyone who's done those amount of shows, it'd probably be a bantamweight gang that'd be so flat.
They'd be so burnt out by now.
That's what I mean. They'd be a bantamweight. They'd have lost everything.
Let me just throw David in on this one for a second because Chris, of course, always reads my mind. I read his mind. I was going to talk Cal Ripken. He is the most consistent baseball player. He did the most games. He beat the Iron Horses record, Lou Gehrig. And, he's not the best baseball player of all time, but he was the most consistent. He was always there. He was a star player. You know, Dexter did something amazing, because you could say, well, if he doesn't have the most wins, he's probably close to the most wins, and he will have the most wins at some point. I don't know. It's between him and Ronnie Coleman at this point. He might have passed him at this point, but he will have the most wins at one point. He'll have the most Arnold victories, probably maybe forever. And he won an Olympia, and arguably he won two Olympias, because, you know, a lot of people feel he could have won this year's Olympia as well. So he somehow finds a way to win. And I think that the true mark or the true statistic of a champion is the ability to win shows. And he might not be the biggest guy. He might not be the craziest, you know, freakiest, you know, proportion guy. But he wins shows. And I think that's an important statistic that might be the most important one. Dorian used to win shows too, but Dorian's body didn't last as many years as Dexter's did. And that's why statistically, I think Dexter is number one. Is he the greatest bodybuilder of all time? Of course not. But statistically, I think you have to say Dexter's the man.
Let's go to the next part of this, because this is a part of the conversation that did come up. And Dennis, you're the first one that brought it up, so we'll go to you first on this. Earlier this week on the Pro Bodybuilding Weekly show with Dan Solomon, IFBB head judge Steve Weinberger, when asked how close it was between Phil and Dexter, he said, well, Phil won by a nose. Now, of course, there's going to be debate. There's going to be all sorts of prognostications as far as whether or not Dexter did win this show. In fact, so Dennis, let's go back to you on this one, because you initially brought it up. How did you see it playing out? And what did you think of Steve Weinberger's comments about how close it really was between Phil and Dexter?
Okay, I'm sorry, but I just got kicked off, so I didn't hear the first part of the question. Can you just repeat it real fast?
Sure. No, again, you're the first one that brought it up. I mean, as far as if Dexter had won, would anybody have had a legitimate gripe? And again, Steve Weinberger, IFBB head judge, was on the Pro Bodybuilding Weekly show with Dan Solomon, and when asked as far as how close it was, he said that Phil won, quote, by a nose. How did you see it, and would you have a legitimate gripe if it had gone the other way?
Well, it was very hard for me to see, because I had that little screen in the back where everybody looked off to me. So, you know, it's not like the big screens you have outside when you can't see the stage and everybody looks peeled, even if they're not. So on my screen, everybody was somewhat off, and I couldn't really see until they put them together. But the thing was, I saw the guys come out individually. When Dex came out, I saw immediately that he was on compared to the guys ahead of him. And I'm going to tell you this. I told Dexter, right after prejudging, I went to Dexter and I told him, I said, Dexter, you're going to get second at worst. I told him, you can ask him today. I told him after prejudging, he didn't really believe me. I said, listen, that's really how good you looked on stage today. And the thing is this, and this is what I always said, if anybody is off, what I'm saying is, if Dennis and Sean would have been 100%, it might have been a different story. I don't know. But if they leave the door open, Dexter will slam that door, and that's exactly what he always does. You know? And I say this. If Phil wouldn't have came in the way he did on Saturday, because he was considerably better Saturday, I think that Dexter would have won that show. And even with Phil coming in Saturday, if they would have gave first to Dexter, nobody would have complained.
John, let's go to you on this one. Again, the quote was that Phil Heath won the show by a nose. How did you see it between Phil and Dexter?
Well, I'm one of those guys that believes that the computer is the better way to watch the show, because, you know, we look at still pictures, you can blow them up, you can put them next to each other. I think we get a much more detailed look at who's doing what when we analyze these things, especially between pre-judging and the finals. And, you know, I saw when I saw Dexter come out at the beginning, the first images I saw of him, I was like, this is unbelievable. I cannot believe this guy at 46 years old keeps bringing it and bringing it and bringing it. And now he looks better than he's ever looked, as far as I was concerned. This idea that you got to knock the champ out is getting a little bit played, because I think it breeds too much wiggle room in the camp of the champ. I think the champ has got to be a little bit more afraid of who's coming up behind him, because for me, Dexter Jackson could be Mr. Olympia again right now, and I don't think anybody in this whole, not only right here on this crew, but anybody else in the whole freaking industry would be complaining right now. So I would actually be hearing more complaints now that Phil beat Dexter versus if Dexter beat Phil. So me, I had Dexter winning the show. I had him winning the show the second he came out. So, you know, this idea that you got to knock the champ out is bullshit. You just got to be the best guy on stage that day. And the best guy on stage that day was Dexter Jackson, period. End of story. All the other commentary can go out the window, because that's just an undeniable fact.
Because John brings up a very compelling point, and that is the whole concept of knocking the champ out, and that is a point that was discussed during your broadcast. Where do you fall on that? A, do you believe that is a truism, and that is something that should be a criteria when judging these kind of shows are really deciding first and second place? Second, did you see Phil having that much of an advantage where the not the champ out difference really played in his favor?
Is that towards me?
Oh, that was me?
Yeah. I'm asking you your opinion as far as where you fall on whether or not the champ should have that leeway that John just discussed.
Well, if you should have or shouldn't, you know, it's just been that way for such a long time. And like I said, Phil was not at his best on Friday. He came Saturday and he was basically what people expected from him on Friday. And I think that gave him the notch. And I think that's okay, because he is the champ and he represented like a champ on Saturday. You know what I mean? I think if he wouldn't have nailed it on Saturday, he would have probably had some serious issues. You know what I mean? But I think it's okay the way it worked right now. I don't think that you have to knock the champ out is really what it's like. We just say that all the time, because when somebody is reigning as a Mr. Olympia, you always look at this person, you always see him better than he sometimes really is anyways. Because we looked at Ronnie how many years and we said, oh, he was off. How come did he win? Because he was Ronnie and people look at him as a champ. You know what I mean? So therefore I say, I don't believe that Steve gave the win to Phil because he thought that he's the champion and he deserved it. I think he gave it to him based on Saturday, and supposedly Saturday is judged 50%. And based on that, I think that it's okay for Phil to be the Olympic champion this year. But like I said, if they would have gave it to Dexter, I wouldn't have a problem at all.
But what does that mean anyway? What does it mean, knock the champ out? You mean you got to bring a fucking baseball bat on stage with you? What does that mean? I mean, Dexter Jackson showed up the best in his freaking life. He was definitely better than Phil. What does that mean? You got to knock him out. You got to punch him. What does that mean? To me, it's the best guy on stage should win. There's no question during pre-judging when the show was decided, Dexter was the best. So,
well, then you have the show, John.
John, the show is no longer decided in pre-judging. So we have confirmation round. So it's 50% Friday and 50% Saturday. So. And it was close Friday.
Yeah.
Phil did not have perfect score on Friday. No, so that shows you that they judged him that he was not 100%. And then was he better than the year before? Yes. But he was flat. So
but was he better? But was he was better on Saturday, but was he better than Dexter? And I say no.
I'm gonna disagree with both these guys. I think that Sean Roden was the best at prejudging. And you know what? The judges only had him down by 2 points. So Roden was in second place after prejudging behind Phil Heath, who I don't know how was in the first position. I would have probably had Dexter and Roden, you know, one and two. But, you know, I think Phil was surging a little bit at the end of prejudging. I thought Roden clearly won prejudging. I thought he came back the next day and he wasn't better. And I think that hurt him. Because Phil got better, I think Dexter got better, Wolf got worse, and I think that's why we saw the placings the way they were. I think, you know, had Roden come back better, he might be Mr. Olympia. So I don't necessarily know if Dexter deserved to win the Olympia, but at the night show, he certainly was at least challenging Phil. I think with the third place that he picked up after, or I think he was in third or fourth place after prejudging, I don't know if mathematically he could have won the Olympia with Phil coming back so much better. But, you know, the problem was, and Dennis stated this right in the beginning, was no one really looked their best. Dexter was kind of the most consistent guy, but once again, he's smaller than everyone else. So once again, when the most consistent guy is on and everyone else is a little off, he makes them look bad, and I think that's what happened. Once again, Dexter made these other guys look bad, especially at the finals, and that's why it wound up the way it did.
Dave, let's get a quick thought on you from you regarding what John said, regarding him not agreeing with the champ getting that kind of a leeway or having to knock the champ out. Where do you stand on that?
Well, I mean, you know, in boxing, if a fight is tied, okay, at the end, the champ gets the win. So if it's close, you know, you're going to give it to Phil Heath. And I think what happened was at the Olympia was no one really knocked the champ out. You know, Dexter didn't knock Phil Heath out. He gave him a run for his money, especially because Phil was off, but he didn't knock him out in my mind. And I think that's why Phil Heath is still Mr. Olympia. Had Phil come back looking like he did at prejudging, Dexter would be Mr. Olympia.
You're watching Iron Debate on RxMuscle.com, live from the RX Muscle Studios here in New York, brought to you by SciTech Nutrition and Quest Nutrition. SciTech sponsoring all of our post-Olympia coverage and the coverage during October. And, of course, Quest Nutrition, our longtime sponsor. Visit SciTechNutrition.com and QuestNutrition.com. We now move on to our next subject. And we broke this news at the end of the night. At the end of the Saturday, the night show on Saturday night, that Big Ramy, we had confirmed from a very reputable source that Big Ramy was no longer going to be working with George Farah, that him and his team had agreed that they were going to be hiring, or in this case, rehiring, Chris Aceto. Since that point in time, there has been a lot of he said, she said, and really not a lot of confirmation insofar as where Big Ramy was going to go. This is a crucial stretch in his career when you think about where he placed in the Olympia and the last couple of years and what his expectations are, what his potential is. Everyone is wax poetic about what he can be if he comes in shredded. The day after the Olympia, the superstar seminar, all the athletes said in unison that if he comes in shredded, we're all in trouble. So, Dennis, we're going to start with you on this one. There's a lot of familiarity on this panel about Big Ramy, so we'll go to you first on this one. Will Big Ramy stay with George Farah? Will he go to Chris Aceto, or is he going to go to another trainer for his 2015-2016 season?
Well, I believe that Ramy is very confused right now. And let's not look at the placing, because when we look at the placing, we'll say he's actually moving up. He's getting better every year. He's moving up. But I would say that at this point, he's confused strictly because he was not in shape. And I think his condition this year was worse than it was last year. Last year, we had a hamstring tear, which, you know, prevented him from training the last couple of weeks, especially, I mean, you know, legs and back and stuff like this. But now, I don't think it's in Rami's hands. Rami wants to win the Olympia. That's his goal. I don't know who put it in his head to say at the press conference that he's not only the biggest, but he will also be the most shredded guy on stage. I don't know where that came from, who fed him that bullshit. But but the thing is this. He is still young in this business. He still doesn't really know how to talk to people when it comes to being in Miss Olympia. When you come from being a fisherman on a ship catching fish to make a living, and the next thing you know is the whole world speaks about you being the best bodybuilder on the planet, saying you're going to be Miss Olympia regardless, and blah 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 blah. Plus, then you have the camel crew over there in Kuwait telling him that, you got to follow us and then you're going to make it, otherwise you'll never make it, because he doesn't believe that without these people he can't make it. I'll tell you this. It doesn't matter who Rami will work with. And as long as he stays over there and is ruled and dictated by the fake princes, then he will never be in shape. That's simple as that. He needs to get away from there. He needs to be over here. And it doesn't matter who he chooses. I personally think if he works with Chris, because I don't think he will stay with Farah, because it was definitely not a success. I mean, he looked his worst ever, I have to say. It's only...
And again, Big Rami tipping in now. There are dueling reports whether he was 315, 316 at the Olympia pre-weigh-in. Nonetheless, he was bigger than we've ever seen him, and that doesn't always equal success. And this is a crucial stretch in his career. How do you read this? Who do you see him going with for his 2015-2016 contest prep and eventually the man who's going to guide him through the 2016 contest season? Dave, let's go to you in studio again. The topic is Big Rami. How do you see him going forward as he prepares for 2015-2016?
Well, I think the problem is that there is a lack of truth and honesty going on with all parties. I can't blame George for everything, even though I'd like to, because I think he's being lied to too, which is ironic because he's usually the one doing the lying. But I don't think George even knows if Rami's listening to him. I know Rami's got people, you know, in his ears, whispering in his ears over there in the Middle East and helping him out. So I don't know if Rami's actually, you know, following what anyone says. I know that Rami has told Chris that he wants to work with him. I know that he sat down with him for hours at a time after the Olympia and talked about working with him. Will that ever come to fruition? I don't know, because I know Chris Aceto. If Chris Aceto's not running the show, Chris Aceto won't be working with Rami. And that could be a big impediment. You know, I think at this point, George is basically a lame duck president, you know, so to speak. He is still the official coach, but he's really not the coach anymore. He doesn't know. He doesn't even know that he's been fired, I think, because I think Rami is afraid to tell him or hasn't told him yet. I think within the next couple of weeks, we'll find out exactly who is going to be Rami's coach. I hope it's Chris Aceto, because I believe that Chris really can do some great stuff with Rami and help him at least be the best Rami that he can be. Is that going to be good enough to win the Olympia? We all think it is, but I would like to see Rami maybe get on the Arnold Classic stage in March and see what he can do for himself there first, use that as a testing ground, and then go to the Olympia later in the year.
Dennis, you brought up a point, and I want you to expound upon it a little bit. You said so long as Big Rami is living and training over in the Middle East, in order for Big Rami to be successful in this upcoming year, do you believe that he needs to be here in the United States with whoever is coaching him throughout this contest prep?
He could be in Mumbai, New Delhi. He needs to be away from over there. That's strictly because I'm telling you right now, he wants to listen to his coach, he can't, because he's being forced to do things that he doesn't want to do. And I know that for a fact. Because blamed, they're going to, and I'm not blaming George for this mishap, because I'm pretty sure that this is coming from over there, that they've basically messed him up again. Because I'm going to give you a short example. And the first Olympia, after he won the New York Pro, I had him literally so stage ready by the time we left here for Vegas. We drove to Vegas. He was so ready. He was really 15-20% better than New York. And then I gave him his diet for Tacoba. Everything was perfect. He had his room. He was checked in. And what I didn't know is, this is what Rami told me afterwards, they came every 2 hours with two bags of watermelon, grapes, and other fruits, and made him eat it with his pop-up meal. Made him eat it. I said, Rami, why the fuck did you eat it? Oh, I have to. What can I do? He's so scared of these people. He's so scared of this man, because this man is putting pressure on him, because in Kuwait, when you're from Egypt, that means you are nobody. You're an Egyptian. That means you'd be a cab driver or a fisher, but you ain't got...
Oh, man, you know what? I hate that we lost Dennis in middle of an epic rant. John, you want to pick up where Dennis left off?
Do we have
Dennis back?
On, Johnny?
All right, so we got everyone. Hold on a second. Dennis, do we have you?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay, can you please pick up where you left off? We lost you for a second there.
Yeah. Why I know that it's not going to work while he's there is because I know from, and this is not from different sources, this is coming from Robbie, that I tell him what to do, and he gets called into the office at the gym, and they're going to force him to put stuff in his body in front of him to make sure he's doing what he was supposed to do from his side. I tell him to do cardio. He said, no, you're not doing cardio. They have cameras in the gym. Every time he stepped on the cardio machine, he got a phone call, get off the step mill. So I'm telling you, and I know Chris would make it happen. Just like I had him at that point where I know I would have made it happen, but he's got to be here. If he's here and he has no influence from over there, you can get this man in shape. But if he's over there, I guarantee you all they're doing is they're going to go through every coach. They're going to get everybody's protocols, and so they can do their own thing over there. Somebody wants to be the godfather of the Middle East or the godfather of whoever goes to the Mecca in Saudi Arabia, whatever. He wants to be the godfather, and he wants to learn from everybody, because I remember these people when they didn't even know how to spell bodybuilding. You know what I mean? So all of a sudden they want to be the guru and get people in shape. You know what I mean? So I'm afraid that they're going to use Chris just like they use George, just like he admittedly used me just for hype for Rami to get him out there. That's all it is. That's all it is. So, and if Chris works with him, which I think would be a good idea, but if he's over there, I guarantee you it's not going to work.
Chris, do we have you now?
The blame is going to go to Chris. He's going to get blamed for something they fuck up. That's what they do. They will fuck it up for you, because I don't know if they're scared for him to be Mr. Olympia and he's going to leave. Because when I had him here, they offered him all kind of money to come back to Kuwait. And at the end, didn't even pay him, not $1. So it's all power and just pressure. And he was worried about his family and his wife and his daughters. You know what I mean? That's what they play. So I could care less about these people over there. I'm just saying that if he wants to be somebody in this sport, he's got to do it the right way. This is not the right way.
Chris, we have you now?
Yeah, that's why I enjoy working with Dusty Hanshaw. He's going to be peeled on Saturday in Phoenix. Because he does what he's supposed to do. And, listening to what DJ has to say, something's wrong, because Rami was a certifiable disaster showing at prejudging at the Olympia, correct?
Yep.
Yes.
And actually, I wanted just to, because I cut out. I hate when we rewrite history a little bit about that. I didn't get a chance to comment on the prejudging of the Olympia, but all intent and purposes, the story after prejudging, right, was Sean Roden. It wasn't Dexter.
I clarified that for everyone. Don't worry about it.
Okay. Okay. No, because I clarify. I just did this. You know. Anyways, we can revisit that. Let's stay on Rami for a second. What is the topic? Is he going to go with George or Chris? Yeah. And DJ says it doesn't matter, right?
Well, yeah, that's what we're trying to...
It doesn't matter who he's going to go with unless he leaves the country. And if he's here or he's somewhere else and it's not controlled by Kuwait, then he can go with anybody, because all he has to do is
I'll tell you what's problematic about it is in pre-judging, he was a disaster. In the press conference, he was a disaster, and that he said he was shredded. So either he thought he was shredded, and somebody told him he was shredded, but we know he was not shredded. And I told you, DJ, we did the wrap-up of the press conference, and I said, I don't know how full or how round Dexter's going to be, but he has the face of a skeleton, and you don't have to have a face of a skeleton necessarily to be ripped. But you can't be, and I said, you can't look like you just came from Taco Bell either. So the idea, if you're a competitor, that you are going into the biggest show in the world the next day and you believe you're peeled, then that is the same problem in Brazil. He was not peeled, but people were saying he was peeled. I mean, I reserved the word peeled for like impeccable condition, not like 4 weeks out condition.
Right.
So post-Olympia, you know, after prejudging, I was contacted. And someone said, someone close, and you know who they are, DJ, you know, they have an entourage. Someone said, two people said, Rami wants to work with you. And I said, when did he make that decision? After he was left out of the first call-out?
No, he wasn't the first call-out.
Oh, he was? Well, when he realized, I'm in the first call-out, but I'm getting dusted.
But they kept him in the call-out. So when they took four back, he was still there.
Well, okay, so he decided in prejudging, I guess. Or between the watermelons and the grapes after prejudging.
Exactly.
You know, the point is you can't be so misdirected that you were deciding to switch coaches. And I'm defending George here, which I want to rip off my tongue for doing. But you can't, you know, abandon, you know, your strategy or your focus or your coach or three of those 9.5 minutes after prejudging. So unless something is weird or odd or wrong. So, you know, before the show started, you know, we talked a little bit about the mindset of a Mr. Olympia. You know, Rami has the body of the Mr. Olympia, but, you know, and he may have the focus to be able to train hard and diet, but something is missing in terms of, you know, I need to be able to focus on this show, because if I can focus on this show and think of nothing else, I can decimate the show. And that's you know that, I know that, everyone knows that. But to come into the prejudging, I know this. If I was working with Rami and he came into prejudging looking like that, they probably would have charged me 10 grand for seats in the future. Or, you know, I mean, I'd be run out of bodybuilding. I say that facetiously, but can you imagine the heat that would have come down if I had brought him in? I guess George has the cursive tongue that can just, like, you know, fall into denial and talk about it like it didn't happen. But we all saw you the second he came out, it was like 3-2-1 from behind the curtain. He's way off. That was my assessment. And, you know, and it's sad in the sense that we have high expectations for him. It's sad in that by most accounts, he's a great guy, but it's not sad in that it's a bodybuilding event and an athletic event. And I hate Phil Heath. But I think he's a smoking bodybuilder. You know what I mean? In other words, it doesn't matter that you're a nice guy. It doesn't matter that fans love you and adore you. What matters is if you get the job done, which means bring your best onto the stage. And, you know, it's not – obviously, you know, better than anyone. It's not his desire, will, all these things. Something is going haywire.
Chris, let's make a prediction or break some news. Will Big Rami proceed with George Farah, or will he be working with you in the 2015-2016 contest season?
Ask Dennis James.
We want your prediction, yes or no?
Oh, yeah. Listen, if history means anything, then I'm out of the picture. whether I've sat, which I have with Rami, for a long period of time in Europe and discussed things, it means nothing. It means nothing when obviously now when I'm hearing from DJ where, you know, you're suggesting do A, B, C, and it's A, B, and C with watermelon and grapes at each meal. I mean, that alone, you know, I'll tell you what. If someone did this, you know what drives me fucking nuts? When someone goes like this, oh, I, you know, Friday night before the show, I had 3 cups of rice instead of the 1 cup that you told me. I'd be like, bye. Right out of the hotel room. Goodbye. Where are you going? I wouldn't even respond. I wouldn't even respond.
Chris, you want to know how bad it is? Think about it. You have social media, emails. Guess who has all the passwords?
Yeah.
Everything goes there before it goes to him. Every diet. Rami didn't know that I wrote his diets way before I worked with him. I was writing his diets and his cycles before I even worked with him officially. He didn't know until he one time sat on his computer and saw all the emails where I sent to him for Rami.
Yeah, well, you know what, DJ, is, you know what, I'm not that, you know, whether I work with someone or not, I just don't care that much. I mean, if you know, he could go work with. I know this. When he was working with George DJ, someone else, someone else was almost in the picture as well at the same time. I just found that out. I don't want to say who it is but I know for sure that somebody else almost came in as a third guru. So from me to George to someone else.
They need the information, and it's not Robbie. He's just playing the game. He's just being the one that's being pushed around doing what they want to do.
Simple as that. You know, I don't like to be played by anyone. I felt I was played the first time around. And then, you know, the second time around, I don't care that much.
We're going to move on now to our next topic. Again, you're watching Iron Debate right here on RxMuscle.com, brought to you by Scientech Nutrition and Quest Nutrition. Reminder, this weekend, Scientech Nutrition will be sponsoring our coverage of the Nordic Pro. And, of course, Dave, you snuck me this note reminding everyone that Cedric McMillan is going to be back in the lineup. Of course, he was the notable omission from the Olympia, suffering. Dave, if you want to clarify, he had he was vomiting, correct? He had some sort of a stomach virus or something?
Peanut allergy, right, Chris?
Do we lose Chris again?
All right. I heard he was a peanut allergy, yeah.
So we're going to move on now to our next topic. And again, one of the big topics or subplots, you want to talk about timing and maximizing your press during Olympia weekend, was the announcement of Lee Thompson's newly formed NPC Global. Now, of course, the name in and of itself ushered in all sorts of debate as far as copyright infringements, but the mere fact that there is a rival or new organization that is now being formed obviously is going to cause a firestorm of discussion as far as, okay, now that it's here, now that it's legitimate, who's going, who's staying, and is this something that could any sort of a thorn in the side of the IFBB and NPC. Of course, that weekend, many of the athletes stepped forward, were very proactive about pledging their allegiance to the IFBB and the NPC. Phil Heath coming out and saying, listen, for the athletes that are performing in the IFBB and in the NPC that have gained a platform, they owe a lot to the IFBB and the NPC. So, John Romano, we're going to start with you first on this one. With Lee Thompson forming the NPC Global, is this good or bad for the sport?
This is more wrong with this whole thing than the Girl Scouts picketing in front of Planned Parenthood. Because it's not equitable. There's no comparison. You're saying a rival organization. A rival organization would mean that you're offering an equal footing, and this is not the case. There's the IFBB and the NPC, or the way it's structured, is the IFBB is the global professional organization, and each country has a national organization that's recognized by the IFBB. In the United States, that's the NPC. So in order to turn pro and compete for the Mr. Olympia, you have to turn pro in the NPC. It's a chain. It goes from the beginning, birth, to the end. Now, what is being offered by this knockoff organization? Beyond the fact that it violates every single patent, copyright and trademark law known in the United States. Beyond that, what are they offering? All it is an amateur organization that's not even an amateur organization because there's revenue sharing. So what exactly are they offering? You're going to have a pro go over there, and what's the pro going to compete for? Mr. Global NPC Pro? What the fuck is that? There's no prestige. There's no 50-year lineage of pro of champions. There's no Arnold Schwarzenegger and Dorian Yates and Lee Haney and Ronnie Coleman, reigns in the past that you can aspire to achieve. There's nothing. There's absolutely nothing but the suggestion of some money that nobody knows where it's coming from. You know, in the amateurs, when you compete as an amateur, you pay an entry fee. And, so you have 1,000 people who go into the nationals or the USA. The promoter gets all this money and he puts on the show and that's how he makes his money. In the pros, you don't pay. You don't pay an entry fee. You pay your pro card at the beginning of the year and you don't pay an entry fee. And you win prize money based on what the take is, between the sponsors and the gate. So what's the structure here on this NPC global knockoff? There's just nothing. You're attracting people who are supposedly disgruntled with the current situation. But what's wrong with the current situation? You have an entry, into bodybuilding or bikini or fitness or figure or whatever through the NPC as an amateur. You compete and the regional level and the state level and then, and the national level. You win your pro card, you compete as a pro, and then you win money and you get sponsorship and all the other things that we're used to. But there's no comparison on what Thompson is offering. What is Thompson offering is the question. So these people are these supposed, renegades who are going to move over there. What are they moving over to? What are they getting? And that's the question that has not been answered. He's got one organization. We don't know if it's pro or amateur. We can't figure it out because amateurs are not supposed to win money or be paid other than tuition. Pros make money, but where's this money coming from? So there's no discernible path from entry into NPC Global. It'll never be able to be called that. Let's call it Global, and a pro status like the Mr. Olympia or the Arnold Classic. There's none of that. There's no lineage. There's nothing. So what is Thompson offering? It's not a rival organization. It's an opportunity for some people who feel that maybe they weren't treated right over here to go over there and maybe make some money. Other than that, there's no prestige. There's no lineage. There's no prize. There's no pro. There's no nothing. So I don't know what this means by rival organization.
Dennis, let's go to you. Where do you fall on this?
Well, that's a bunch of bullshit. That's all I'm going to say. And John is totally right. He ain't offering nothing but a lot of talk. That's the exact same thing he was doing while he was still in the NPC and the IFBB. Talk. You know what I mean? And he's known by people that know him that he likes to talk. Because 80% of what he says is a bunch of bullshit anyways. He likes to play people out. He likes to play like he had a major role in the IFBB. He acted like he was the man, He was the one that head judging the shows overseas because nobody else wanted to go overseas and he paid for his own flight. So that was the easiest way to get the head judge over there. So, but he thinks that he is big enough to start his own organization and everybody's going to leave something that's been established for so long. He must be out of his mind. he's probably using his own money to fund this thing, and it's going to take a real short time for him to realize that this is the worst business decision he ever made, and it's going to go to shit. It's the same thing that happened years ago with Vince McMahon when he started his federation, and he offered big money to some of the pros to come over, which they did because he offered them money. I know from Gary Strider, he got $1 million contract from Vince McMahon to come over to, what was it, BFD, whatever, WDF. You know, that's why they left, because they got the money. It was contracts. But at the end, he lost money, and it's no good business decision. And that's why I'm telling you right now, it's going to be a bunch of bullshit. And the people that's going to go over there, the pros, supposedly, is going to go over there and compete are the ones that couldn't win the Mr. Health Food Store at the Gold's Gym. You know what I mean? And that's why they're going over there, because they ain't doing shit anyway, so they might as well go to shit and stay shit. That's all I have to say. There's nothing else. I'm not even wasting another minute on NPC condom or whatever they call it. You know what I mean? I'm not wasting another minute. And I'm telling you this, NPC and the IFBB has been here forever. And there's no way that you're going to start some new shit and you're going to be as successful as they've been doing for after, I don't know how many years, 40 years? How many years is it now?
50.
Yeah, 50 years. So show us something before you run your mouth.
But, Dennis, you make a good point. It's that there's... That you're not attracting the A-team. You know, who's going to go over there? The guy, you're just like you said, the guy who can't win the Mr. Health Food Store. Exactly. You're not getting the best and the brightest going over there. You're getting the D-team. So who's going to pay big money to go see mediocre talent? That's the best he's going to get.
What's his name? Tried to say bullshit. Here, Troy Ells here from Arizona. He tried to do his own organization where he figured out that he can't even compete with the 212. He started his own bullshit saying, I'm going to do my own federation. And then he's going to go on the radio saying, I'm doing this because I want the people to get judged fairly. Who do you think is going to come over there because you are starting something new and they're going to compete for your show? And then he ended up doing two shows with fucking... 20 competitors on stage and 15 people in the audience, you know what I mean? And then, and then you're back in the gym training people because that's what you do.
Chris,
you know
let's get a thought from you on this.
That's what's going to happen here. It's going to go to shits. That's it.
I agree.
Chris, let's get a thought on you on this.
I actually disagree with PJ.
Go ahead.
PJ, I disagree with you. So I think you say Lee Thompson is all talk. I think he's all action. He was all action in Brazil when Cedric was late for a meeting.
That was action that didn't come. Yeah,
That's my point. He was didn't all action there. He was all action when Lionel Baiki was relegated to not first place at that show.
Yeah, but what does that show? That show that that you can't trust him from here to next across the street.
Well, therein lies my point. You said he's all talk. I said he actually is all action, all bad action. Right. You know, that weekend, That weekend, the action that he took when a competitor, along with NyQuil Sean Ray, edging him on, when a competitor is late for a meeting and the head judge, Lee Thompson, says, I'm going to teach you a lesson. And I was standing right there when he was late for the meeting and he was coming in, and Cedric, in his most polite, don't escalate things, the right way to get to explain to Lee what was exactly going on, Lee would have with his temper, nothing of it. And then the following year, same country, we all know the winner shouldn't have been the winner. I said that at the wrap-up. I said it on RX Muscle. The only person who defended him was Bob Ciccarillo. So,
of course.
You know what? The point being is this. He's the wrong person to start an organization because you need a track record. But even if you don't have a track record, if you have an idea and you are known as an honest person, somebody can follow, then you might have some type of leeway in getting something off the ground, be it a business, be it a bodybuilding organization, and he does not have that.
It already shows you when you think about how it all came about. A week before he announced what he's doing, he went to Pittsburgh. What was it, the Masters, or what did we have in Pittsburgh not too long ago? Crying over there. how all these rumors is such a bullshit. And he's looking up to Jim and he's my mentor, blah, 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 blah. Then he goes home and puts something on Instagram or Facebook that, you know, all this shit is settled, you know, he's NPC forever and blah, 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 blah. Then the shit hits the fan with Kai Greene and he jumps boards and talking about because of the situation with Kai makes him do what he's doing right now. That tells you already that you can trust him from here to the safe I got here, right here. And that's about 2.5 feet. You know what I'm saying? And I just feel bad for all the athletes because, I mean, there won't be much. But every single athlete that's going over there because they expect that, who knows what he tells them. You're going to make a shitload of money. You don't need the IFBB. You're going to get paid. You know what I mean? And he might take a couple of dollars out of his own pocket and feed these people with some bullshit. You know what I mean? But at the end of the day, he's a businessman. He's going to shut that shit down because it's going to cost.
And that's the end of the career of the athlete that went over there. Because once you leave, you're not coming back.
He doesn't even know how much money he's losing by losing all his shows, his state championship, all the successful shows he built in Texas. Does he really believe that all these athletes are going to do his shows now? If he believes that, he must be smoking some serious weed that I need to get a hold of.
All right, Dave, let's get a final word on you on this one again. NPC Global, Lee Thompson, and of course, maximizing his press, really making this big announcement around the time of Olympia weekend. Where do you stand on this?
Well, you know, competition is always good, okay? So we can't say the competition is not good because look what happened with Vince McMahon. When Vince McMahon started the WBF and started handing out big-time contracts, it forced Joe Weider to do the same. And I had Rich Gasparri on the show, and Richie didn't go over to the WBF, but he did wind up getting a contract from Joe Weider, which made more money, infused the industry with more money. The athletes were getting paid better. So, in essence, Vince McMahon's move in the WBF was good for bodybuilding. So the problem with Lee Thompson is he talks about profit sharing, but Romano brings up a great point. Where's the money coming from? Where's the profits coming from? There are none. It's window dressing. If Lee Thompson was handing out $100,000 a year contracts to athletes, I'd say, bravo. You know what? If you guys want to go make some money, go make some money. The athletes have to pay their bills, but there is no money. This is a false hope organization. It's like, I'm going to save you guys. Come to me. But we'll talk about the money later. But you're going to make money. I promise you. That, you know, that's the biggest charlatan. I'm surprised, you know, I don't even want to bring him up, but we know people that have promised more things than that and gotten people to follow them. The bottom line is that there is nothing. It's paper mache, as my dad would say. You know, it's tissue paper. The promises are empty. There's obviously if you're going to leave the IFBB as a pro bodybuilder or a pro athlete for that matter, there better be something there waiting for you that is promising you. Now, if Donald Trump started an organization, said I'm going to give you $1 million a year, you know, now you got something that you got to, you know, sit down. You know what? I'm going to make $1 million. Maybe I should leave. But, you know, what is Thompson really offering?
Because they would have to understand that.
He's offering three bikini divisions. One, we're going to have bikini beach body. We're going to have athlete body. We're going to have jerk-off body. We're going to have whatever the case may be, wellness for Johnny Styles. Maybe we even throw a fifth bikini division in there. I mean, I guess if you make enough divisions, everyone can be a champion, right? Everyone who enters can be a champion, you know? It's like Little League baseball. No one wins, you know, or everyone wins.
Everyone
wins. So that to me is not what I wanted. When I went into competing and I was up on stage next to Dennis James, I wanted to beat Dennis James. I didn't want to go to another organization so I didn't have to compete against Dennis James. And I think that's where the shortcoming is of this whole thing.
We're now going to move on to our last topic of debate. Again, you're watching Iron Debate on RxMuscle.com. Follow along in the Muscle Central Forum on rxmuscle.com. If you're not already a member, it is free to register. Of course, we will be continuing our post-Olympia coverage with the Nordic Pro this weekend. All our coverage this month brought to you by SciTech Nutrition. Visit SciTechNutrition.com and, of course, our longtime sponsor, Quest Nutrition. Try their new pumpkin spice bar. It is amazing. QuestNutrition.com. We now move to our fourth topic of debate. And that is a man that was brought up earlier on in the show. It is a man that's been brought up throughout 2014, 2015. Sean Roden. Sean Roden finishing third at the Olympia, second at the Arnold Europe, and then third at the Prague Pro. And many thought coming into this Olympia, he was the dark horse. He was the trendy pick, per se, to win the Sandow, to dethrone Phil Heath. So Dave and I were talking yesterday, and Dave's observation was, this is a man who has gotten lost in the shuffle. And now the question is this, was he overlooked? Is he underappreciated? So Dennis James, we're going to go to you first on this one. Was Sean Roden collectively snubbed when you look at his 2015 contest placings?
And you know, I will keep it real. Flexitron, for me, was somebody I had very high expectation. I also believe that if he says it's true, that he's going to be bigger. And of course, I believe he was in shape, that he has a very, very good shot at beating Phil. Because, and I say this again, for me, he has the most perfect physique right now that is competing on any IFBB stage. Now, having this perfect physique might have cost him his spots this year, because the first thing that I saw that I didn't like about his physique was when he came out, everything was there. Condition was there. Size, he was considerably bigger. I mean, I instantly saw the size difference. He stood next to Phil, and he had Phil in the shots he said he was going to have him. He literally beat Phil in several shots, but he had one problem, and that was a slight distension. When you have such a small waist, it can only go to the front, but it goes somewhere. There's no way he can go to the side, and it just looked like it was distended. For whatever reason it was, I don't know, and I believe that he got punished. I will say punished, or he was mocked down a little bit for not having that perfect, small, tight waist that he always has. And you saw it in transitioning between poses. You saw it when he's standing relaxed, where he usually never has an issue. He can stand relaxed, his stomach is flat, even if he's not posing it. But that was the only down, the only knock I had on Sean Roden, which I believe cost him at least the second spot this year at the Olympia. I hate to say it, but that's my opinion, and I believe that's what cost him.
John, your observations on Sean Roden insofar as how he plays at the Olympia and then the other two shows at the Arnold Europe and at the Prague Pro in 2015.
You know, personally, I had Sean second place at the Olympia. I had Dexter first, Sean, and then Phil in third place. That's the way I saw it. I think I don't know enough about what's going on, you know, with him in terms of, you know, what he stands for or what, you know, he's bringing behind the scenes. I don't know whether that makes a difference or not. I don't know whether he's not doing enough social media, whether he's not doing enough promotion, whether he's not out there enough to make him a little bit more known. I don't know. I think his physique is amazing. It's like DJ said, it's probably one of the most perfect physiques out there. Being overlooked, though, may be a factor of less freak factor and too much perfection. I think what you need when you're coming in, it's like, why is Big Ramy so popular? Big Ramy's so popular because he's a freaking freak. He comes in at 300 pounds. The guy's a giant, you know, at 5'9", 5'10", whatever he is. He's a freak. We come to these things to see a freak show. We want to see to what is absolutely inhuman. While Sean is inhuman in a certain sense because his waist is so small and he's got that freaky tie-in between his, you know, his obliques and his waistline. You know, he's noticeably bigger, great condition. He's very, very perfect. But it's like, you know, it's like you're in a car show. And you see this, you know, a Mercedes that's just perfect, but it's next to a Ferrari and a Lamborghini. What are you going to look at? You're going to look at the freaky car. You're going to look at the Italian ones because they're more out of sight. They're more larger than life. So I think it's a combination of the factor that he's not so striking in such a way that you look at him and you go, holy shit, what's that? Like you do when you look at Big Ramy, or, you know, he's too maybe the polish is a little too much done. I don't know. I just don't think he brings I just don't think he brings that super wow factor that just draws your eyes to him at the expense of everybody else.
I think his physique does have a wow factor, because when he stands there just alone from the front, I think your eyes are automatically drawn to him, because when you look at the shoulder to waist ratio, I can look at Rami and then I look at Sean. Sean's is obviously there's a bigger ratio there.
I don't disagree with that.
And overlooked. And I don't think he was overlooked. How can you be overlooked? You placed in third at the Olympia.
That's a good point, too. That's a very good point.
Overlooked means you should be second or third, and you placed out of the top 10 or out of the top 6 or 7. I mean, he wasn't overlooked. I think he was.
That's an absolutely tremendous point, DJ. I mean, like, guy who was overlooked, Johnny Jackson was overlooked. He got 15th place.
True, that's
overlooked.
William Beck almost got overlooked.
Absolutely. So I don't think he's being overlooked. I think what you guys are looking for is that, why isn't he winning? And maybe he will. He just needs a little more time in the game. I don't know. But I don't think he's underrated, and I don't think he's overlooked, and I don't think he's somebody who doesn't have potential. I think he's got a tremendous amount of potential, and I think he needs to keep coming back and keep coming back and keep coming back. But I agree with DJ 100%. He's not overlooked. I just think he's not a freak in the sense that, you know, you look at him and you go, what the fuck is that? But he's definitely, he's definitely a contender. You being a top three, top five in the Mr. Olympia or the Arnold Classic, you are not being overlooked.
Let's bring in the man who has probably the most intimate knowledge of Sean Flexitron Roden, and that is Chris. Chris, what did you make of Sean Roden's contest placing in 2015, and what did you make of overall of his performance at the Olympia, prejudging to the finals?
Well, you know, at 2012, if you take a step back, he got third, deservable third. 2012, 2013, he got fourth. Both of those placings are pretty damn accurate, you know. 2012. Third, 2013, fourth, 2014, last year, he was third. All those years, he ends up beating Dexter, correct? By no argument, he came in this year significantly bigger and in tremendous condition. So, for me, you know, I had him winning the prejudging. I think that he was bigger than Wolf, which shocked a lot of people. He won multiple shots in prejudge, and it's up, you know, people argue it different ways, but I was there, and I think Dave will attest to that. And he got lots of first place votes, I understand, in prejudging, and even on the scorecards, he was second coming out of prejudging. And I am told that that was a tremendously close second place coming out of prejudging. So to end up in third, I scratch my head. And I would disagree. I would disagree completely with him not being a freak. In prejudging, he looked like a freak. He looked taller. He looked like the tallest guy in the show and the widest guy in the show. He was, you know, you couldn't get more fullness on that frame for that Friday night. And, you know, you know, arguably he was in a condition that was, you know, matched his fullness.
From you on this one, Sean Roden, you brought this conversation yesterday in the office as far as his placings and whether or not he was overlooked in 2015.
The Olympia, obviously, I had him and Phil very close at prejudging. I probably had it a tie, maybe. I really thought he was better than Phil, but, you know, I was giving Phil the benefit of the doubt. I did think he came back not better on Saturday night, but I didn't have him any worse than second place. So I thought he got snubbed in the sense I think he should have been a solid second at the Olympia. Having said that, when I saw him, and I wasn't there in person, but I saw the pictures, I saw the video from the Arnold Europe the week after, and I thought he looked amazing. I really don't know how he lost the show, because when he's at his best, which I thought he was there, I don't think Dexter could stand next to him. I think he's too big for Dexter. I think his symmetry is better than Dexter's, and I think he's got way more wow than Dexter. Likewise, I don't know how he didn't win in Prague. So I think he did get snubbed. I think he got snubbed more so in the European shows than he did at the Olympia. The Olympia is a hard nut to crack, like you said. Phil did come back better. I think you could have made a case between Dexter and Roden at that Olympia. I would have probably gone with Roden for second place. But, you know, like I said, the problem was Dexter came back better, Roden didn't, and I think that's why Dexter moved up. But the European Tour, I think those were Roden shows. For some reason, Roden never gets really placed very well in Europe. I don't know what it is. He just doesn't seem to do as well as people think he should. You know, when you look at the pictures and you look at what's going on there. The great thing about Sean Roden is he's such a good sport. He doesn't badmouth anyone. He doesn't say poo-poo. He doesn't get mad. He just goes back to the drawing board and gets better. I think if he can keep the size he's got this year, refine it a little bit, like Dennis said, get that, you know, midsection under control, because, you know, we see other bodybuilders with a little bit of a distension in the lower abdomen, but we don't notice it as much, or we don't care about it as much because they don't have a 22-inch waist. On Roden, it looks, it just sticks in your face. You can just see it, and it ruins that beautiful, you know, line that we're used to seeing. So once again, you're not supposed to judge people against their best, their former best. But I think what's happening is the judges are seeing what he looked like last year, and they're saying, all right, yeah, he is bigger and he is hard, but his waistline doesn't look as good. And I think that might be what hurt him, as Dennis said. But bottom line is, Roden might be the most underappreciated athlete, and you know what? Don't be so shocked if he becomes Mr. Olympia next year, because I think he is probably at this point in time, even though he's 40 years old, at his best, you know, and on top of his game.
Sean Roden, 2015, finishing third at the Olympia behind Phil Heath and Dexter Jackson, finishing second at the Arnold. I think we Dennis, let's get you in on this.
I just want to say one more thing regarding Sean Roden, and I just want to see if you guys agree with me on that. For him to win the Mr. Olympia, he has the body, he has everything, he has the shots. I just like to see from Sean to act like he wants to win the Olympia.
Let me add to this. You know what I heard? I heard this after prejudging. The buzz, this is my honest to goodness, straight up analysis of the prejudging. I thought Sean won, and people were coming up to me, you too, DJ, and saying, why didn't he fight for it? And I'm like, you know, I'm like, he won, right? And people are like, yeah, he can win, but why wasn't he getting more aggressive? And I was like, you know, I'll go right into denial, and I said, man, he was aggressive, this and that. You know what somebody who I have a tremendous amount of respect for came up to me on the tour said? Tremendous amount of respect. Old guy, former IFBB judge. He said, you know what, Chris, I hate to say it, and I'm not going to say he needed to be more aggressive. If he had, like, picked a fight and, like, pushed, if he had pushed Phil during some time of prejudging, like, this is my show, he said you would have felt the whole entire prejudging. The
feel he would have it. The crowd. The crowd would be after. The crowd
That's his point. And you know what his other point was? He said the crowd would have loved to see him bully Phil, because Phil is used to bullying people. Huh?
Didn't work for Kai last year.
I know. Listen, Dave, I said that, but they said, but they don't expect it from Sean. So, you know, if Sean, you know, shoves Phil, then, you know, it's a difference than Kai, because Kai's always, you know, out there.
I was already pleasantly surprised when I had Sean, basically saying that he's going to beat Phil in these poses. This is something that Sean probably would never do or never say, but he said it. But I just like to see him to get on that stage and act like I'm here to win this thing. Not only because I have the physique, because I want to physically see, I don't want him to push Phil, not necessarily, but take it to him. Don't walk around like you're high, you know, or something. Go take it to him. This is 5 minutes of your year where you got to show to the world that this is what you want.
How did the show come down to? Listen, 3 years in a row it's come down to Phil and someone else, Kai, on their individual shots.
Kai was not there this year. This was the shot.
And here's my point. How would the show panned out, Phil versus Sean, last call of prejudging?
It would have been perfect. It would have been deserving, of course. But then he had a chance to show everybody how bad he wanted to beat Phil.
And with that,
listen, I understand, but the sniff test for like how bad does he want it sounds is almost as obtuse as the idea of you got to knock the champion out.
Oh, Chris, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying he doesn't want it. I know. This is his personality. He wants it, but he needs to. I would like to see that. And if somebody doesn't know Sean personally, like we do, then they don't know. He thinks, oh, he's just up there just to get it done.
I think the analogy that you're giving, Dennis, is that when Flex Wheeler would fight it out with Dorian Yates and Kevin Lavrone on stage, you'd see let's face it, it's a pageant. You got to perform. It's not just who has the best body. It's how you present that body and in what kind of impact it makes on the judges and the audience. And Sean is not making an impact that he's Mr. Olympia. Phil Heath knows how to make that impact that I'm Mr. Olympia out there. Jay Cutler knew how to make the impact on Mr. Olympia. Ronnie Coleman made the impact on Mr. Olympia. You don't see Mr. Olympia written on Sean's face. And it's sad to say, it plays into the judges' decisions when the final bell rings. And that's what happened. And that's really the final word.
Thank you very much.
We're going to end on that.
End it! Chris, I have the final word! Me!
He said final word, and it's like, well...
Huh?
I have the final word.
Now just teach him how to be a little bit more aggressive. Or send him here. I'll piss him off.
Him out to DJ's house for a week.
I don't know, DJ. You know what? You got him to speak up at the press conference. Next year he might.
Send him out to Bader's house over there at Oxygen Gym. He'll teach him how to do it.
You know what? It's hard to lose to Phil when Phil thinks he's like LeBron James, dude.
But you know, I wasn't in Europe at all. But I'm looking at some pictures, and you know, pictures sometimes. But how did Rami beat Dennis and Sean in Prague?
In my play-by-play, I had Rami fourth. He was fat as a pig in Prague.
How did that happen?
Well, if Rami beats Sean, he should beat Dexter. DJ. If Rami beats Sean, he should beat Dexter, don't you think?
I agree with you.
Exactly. That's exactly what I'm saying. I saw him beat Dennis and Sean. Now he should win the show.
Right.
I agree. I had him fourth place.
But what is that going to put in his team's mind?
Oh, my. That he's peeled. He's going to be 340.
Exactly. What is that going to feed to these guys over there? Oh, you beat the
brother! I figured it out. It took three shows, but I got it, though.
No, I'm not talking about George.
I got it.
I'm talking about the Chihuahua gang.
Where's my George puppet?
What's that?
Oh,
the
Where's my puppet over here? I got to do the final word. Hold on. All right, here we go.
Oh, final word. This is about to happen right now.
Brother, listen to me. I make a mistake at the Olympia. He don't listen to me. They give him watermelon, but I fly out to Prague at the last minute. I give him all the secrets that I give The Rock. And guess what? Rami really win the show, but they give to Dexter, you know, because Dexter is already win, you know, show week before that. But I got him. I am now in charge. Chris Aceto, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
And with that, we say bye-bye to you all. This was a lot of fun. Dennis James, John Romano, Chris Aceto, and of course Dave Palumbo. We thank everyone for joining us on this special episode of Iron Debate. Reminder, this weekend we have full coverage of the Nordic Pro coverage powered by SciTech Nutrition. Visit SciTechNutrition.com. For our producer, Johnny Styles, doing an excellent job as always, I'm Sadiq Faruqi. We will see you next time on RxMuscle.com.